Good morning, Texas. My name is James Tice. I am Tina Lay's Director of Industry Education and Certifications, and I'd like to welcome you to our first Tina Lay webinar of the year. Tina Lay webinars are sponsored by Hotchkiss Insurance and are worth one continuing education unit each. So for those who are trying to gain enough CEUs for your certification renewal in June, hint, hint, please go to tnlaonline.org, click on Programs and Events, then Certification, and you will find a CEU form that you will fill out after today's webinar. Not during, but after today's webinar. Speaking of today's webinar, we will be listening to Selling Smart by McFarland Stanford. McFarland Stanford is a dynamic team of green industry business coaches with international and domestic experience in C-level management from Fortune 100 to small entrepreneurial organizations. They are recognized for dramatically increasing sales volume and profitability through implementing exemplary, say that three times fast, business processes, strategies, and development of loyal teams. TLA will be hosting McFarland Stanford webinars on the third Monday of each month, so mark your calendars now, well, after the webinar. We will also be having an entire half day of face-to-face sessions with McFarland Stanford at this year's Nursery Landscape Expo Education Conference on Thursday, August 8th in San Antonio. So be sure to register for your chance to work with McFarland Stanford in person at Expo this year. Also, don't miss out on Tina Lay's March 4th webinar featuring Dr. Charlie Hall, talking about the mid-year economic outlook. Be on the lookout for registration coming soon to a computer near you. During the webinar, you may be asked, you may ask questions using the controls on the right side of your screen. There is a chat feature and a questions feature. All questions will be handled at the end of the webinar. So I would recommend holding off on typing those questions until close to the end of the webinar, because your question might be answered during the webinar. That being said, I would now like to switch controls over to McFarland Stanford. You might experience a brief pause while this happens. Okay, McFarland Stanford, are you there?
Yes, we're here. James, can you hear us?
Absolutely. Y'all go ahead and get started.
All right. Well, hello and welcome, everybody. This is our first Selling Smart, Mastering the Sales Process, Aligning Your Teams for Success. Jason and I are excited to be with you today, so I just wanted to quickly introduce myself. My name is Chris Pinchuk with McFarland Stanford, as James mentioned earlier. And I lead the Landscape Construction Management Coaching Practice with the emphasis on sales execution here at McFarland Stanford. So excited to be with you guys. I've got just over 20 years of experience working in the industry. I have grown up in the industry and been in landscaping as a landscape professional my entire career. So very excited to be with you all today and be able to share some of my lessons learned and some of the things that we've been successful with working with teams all across the country with everyone here this afternoon. To my right here, my colleague is Jason New. Let Jason introduce himself.
Hello, everyone. Jason New here. Also, I work at McFarland Stanford and working through the coaching practice of operational leadership. Been in the industry for years. If those of you don't know me, hopefully we'll run into you guys at TNLA so I can introduce myself in person. I'm excited to be here with you today as we work through the selling practices and some of the processes that we worked with over the years that are proven successful and helped us grow businesses.
So I know everyone's got a copy of the presentation there. So we went ahead and included a couple nice little headshots there. So we, while we like to think we have a voice for radio, we thought it'd be good if everybody had a face to go with the name so you can see who we are. So as we get to see each other over the years to come, that you can certainly come back up, meet with us, certainly touch base with us anytime you can. So, so diving right in.
Can you share your screen? Chris, can you share your screen for me?
Is it not showing?
It's not showing.
Uh-oh. No, sir, it's not.
Well, let's see what's happening.
Let's see and stop sharing.
Oh, how about that?
Give it a second here. Still nothing.
It says we're showing it.
There it is. Got it.
Here it is.
For some reason it was paused. Apologize about that. All right. Well, there's Chris's face going back over it. And here's Jason's face. So we've got those two things. All right. Next.
All right, so diving in. So I wanted to touch base first and just introduce you to some of our goals for today's time together. What we're going to be focusing on is we're going to talk about the sales process. What is a sales process? We're also going to spend a little bit of time talking about understanding your target market, understanding the value proposition in that target market and how relationships help with execution in that target market. And then we're going to wrap up today with talking about aligning your sales team for success and what that looks like and what we see historically working with the organizations all across the U.S. So to quickly get started, we'll dive right in. We're going to start with sales process. This is typically where I get a show of hands and I kind of ask everybody who in the room actually has a sales process. Today, I'm going to make some assumptions here. The assumptions I'm going to make is probably 50% of you in attendance today have a concrete sales process that you may or may not be using. You may have a sales process that you as the owner have. It's in your head and you feel like your team has it, but your team is not aware of the sales process. And then probably another portion of the room is going to say, never had a sales process, not sure what that looks like, not even sure where to begin. And so we're gonna try and talk to all of those points today to really kind of give you an overall summary of what a sales process is, what that looks like, and why you should have one.
And I might throw in one other piece. As you start looking at this, you may think you have a sales process, but if your team can't regurgitate and repeat this back to you and say, here's what our process is and here's what we're doing, chances are you don't have a process. So make sure if you think you have one, why don't you vet that out, check it out, ask your team what that is on your behalf.
So to quickly dive in, so we're going to talk about how are you tracking? Simple questions. What have I sold? How much have I sold? When is it going to hit? How am I collecting this data? And so we see a lot of you will probably have different sales management tools. Some people use Salesforce. Everybody's going to have their own form of CRM if you have one. That's great. And quite frankly, what we like to say is it doesn't really matter what you're using to track your sales. What we like to see and what I like to see with any organization, is just that you have something, you know? And so, we're not one that's going to push you one way or the other and say, hey, this is the CRM that you need to use for a landscape organization. Because what I found is, a CRM is only as good as the person that's using it. So if you have one and you're not using it, you know, what we're going to encourage you to do is certainly open it up, start putting the information in there, but more importantly, start trying to figure out what you can do to actually make it work for you. Typical CRMs that we see in the industry is Salesforce, Aspire, AX, Microsoft Dynamics, but quite frankly, we've been very successful over the years with just using Excel, you know, and so what I like to say is don't overcomplicate it. If we can have a CRM, let's just be effective with what we're using. Let's make sure that the information that goes in is quality information. And as long as we can have some type of filter function on it to be able to drive to a couple questions to get to the answers that we need, then certainly that's what we wanna try and do. So the main point we wanna drive through with how you're tracking your sales is consistency. Consistency is the key, not necessarily what you're using. What are you tracking and why? What we like to focus on here is touch points with clients, competitors, your margin analysis, your forecasted start. So why are we tracking this information? So, you know, there's a lot of questions that this should spur in your mind as a business owner or as a sales professional, which is, you know, one is what is in my pipeline? You know, is it just opportunities in there or is it actual things that I'm working on currently that could close this month? Or more importantly, is it something that could close in 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 18 months? All of these are good questions that you should be asking yourself as a sales professional or as a sales manager.
You know, Chris, I'm gonna make a comment about that. That's a game changer. And then for those of you that have new team members that come on board and you're working through a training and what you're teaching as far as these salespeople in your team. You know what? Going and tracking these kinds of things and working with a pipeline, that's a new concept. That's not something everyone does, and they practice with it. And so working through the idea of going, okay, I've presented 10 proposals to different customers this week. And let's say you don't close anything. You have all 10 that are still out there. Where do you keep track of that? Those are the kind of things that are really simple concepts, but we find that in our coaching practice and when we go visit with clients, the newer team members and the people that some have just been trained on how to do this do not do a very good job of tracking who they presented things to and what's still outstanding. And they really work on just the new clients that come in for the next estimate. So we lose a lot of opportunities into going back into a pipeline and understanding who's still out there that we could touch base with. And we found from our practices that sometimes takes 3 to 5 follow-ups before someone says yes. And so that becomes a really big deal if we want to start closing more business.
That's a really great point, Jason. You know, so just to give you guys a quick little example, some of the best projects and some of the biggest relationships that I've seen companies have over the years have come from not the quick turn stuff, but more importantly, the stuff that it's kind of a slow burn. It's the things where you've met the person, you've had a couple meetings, you've had a couple introductions. Maybe you feel like you've gotten nowhere with these people over the 3 to 5 phone calls, but it's the consistency of following up with those people and checking in with them over the time and period that really tries to develop that relationship. So our goal is not necessarily that we're gonna close that in day one, but more importantly, we're creating the relationship that could open the door in the future so that when they feel like they are ready to make that call, that you're the one person that they think of and the one person that they feel comfortable going to. Real quick, you wanna go back. I was kind of throwing out some acronyms there earlier. CRM, and for those of you may be familiar with it, but I definitely want to point out that what we're looking at there is customer relationship management. So when we're talking about a sales tracking tool and we say CRM, what we're talking about is a customer relation management aspect of what we're trying to accomplish with driving that process. So other things that we could be tracking, certainly we want to be looking at our revenues. So obviously we're going to look at top line revenues. But we also want to look at gross profit. We want to look at what the bottom line is, you know, so you're going to see ebbs and flows throughout the season based on the seasonality of your work and the type of business you're going to see in different months at different times of year. And we all know that at different times of year, you're going to see that enhancements is going to produce a higher gross profit than probably a commercial sales. So those are all things we want to know as we're starting to drive through this. And, you know, it doesn't matter if you're in floriculture, arboriculture, or if you're just in maintenance, horticultural sales. You know, you're each going to have your own set of gross profits and customer margins that you need to be aware of as you're starting to look through and track these things.
You know, on that, I'm gonna pick Chris's brain here for a moment. He managed a sales team of such a different dynamic and all from different backgrounds. And so I'm excited to see, you know, when we worked with him in the beginning, there was the primary things we tracked. You know, like he mentioned the revenue, right? We needed knowing sales goals, what type of revenue we're selling, how much we're selling. Profitability-wise, we wanted to know if those projects were profitable and understanding if our estimating was accurate. And then we got more detailed, right? As our team became more developed and more in tune with things, you know, to work on us to get better in our sales, we start tracking a few more things in our chart of accounts. Do you remember, you know, it was missed estimates, warranty, and goodwill. Can you talk about that for a moment?
Yeah, so what is goodwill? So goodwill is something that we've always liked to track just for the sheer fact of, I wanna know if in the sales process, if I'm giving something away, or if I feel like I'm giving a discount for X, Y, and Z, or maybe it's something where I'm trying to create a relationship and I'm doing a favor for this person or that person. I wanna know that that's goodwill. I want to know that I know what those dollars are, because me as a sales professional or as a business owner, I also want to know what am I taking away from my ultimate sell that's going to cut into my gross profit at the end of the sell. So definitely something we want to track. Warranty, however, I look the opposite. You know, so warranty is, you know, what have we missed in an estimate? What have we maybe when doing the takeoffs or doing our elevations that we may have overlooked during the sales process? All good questions that we want to ask, and we want to know those answers because those are all factors that are going to ultimately affect our bottom line as an organization, as a sales team. Mm-hmm. Great question, Jason.
And misestimates, this one piece, it was the funniest thing. We used to do construction jobs. As we got larger and able to handle more things, you know, our jobs got larger and we were on the project for a longer period of time. And we consistently missed porta-johns. I mean, I realize when you go into that, it doesn't seem like a significant amount, but when you've got several projects going on at a time and you have to pay $250 a month to rent a porta-john, that we just did not add into our estimates. And we were realizing this much later. We're like, my gosh, we're just giving this away. Why don't we put that in our estimates? So we just put it there. I mean, the client would rather us use a porta-john than go in their personal restroom, trust me.
So good question there is, Jason, is that goodwill or is that warranty?
You know what? I don't know if it's either. That's funny. Yeah, I don't know why I'd call that one. But we certainly found ways to get better at our estimating just by asking ourselves the question, because we realized we weren't hitting the gross profit we wanted.
So going back to the consistency of driving the process. So obviously what we want to do is we want to track our sales. We want to know what we're tracking, why we're tracking it, and we want to be consistent with doing it. So we want to make sure that we're consistently meeting with our team members. We want to make sure that they know the numbers. We want to make sure you know the numbers, because the consistency factor is only as good as the person managing it and the person inputting the data. So let's make sure we know those details.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're trying to change the slide. Got it now. Here we go.
Okay, so consistent sales process check-in. So what you're looking at here is a graph, and this graph may look a little bit intense, and I'll talk through some of the high levels of kind of what we're looking at and kind of the overall arching goal of what we're trying to drive through here. So you see the items in green, which show our monthly actual sales. You also see the bars in yellow, which show our monthly goals. So you see goals in yellow, actuals in green. You're also going to see two lines. The yellow line is your year-to-date goal, which is showing you basically the trajectory of what you're selling and how it's forecasted to go throughout the year based on the goals that you've established. In green, you're gonna see the actual. This is a trend line that's showing you basically where are you in relation to that goal and how are you in projecting towards that goal. So what you're gonna see here, this is exactly what we're talking to when we say we're tracking the numbers, tracking the goals, tracking the forecast, tracking the pipeline. This is the data that we're trying to spit out, where we're trying to get a pulse as a sales manager and as a manager. Me as a sales professional, as I'm selling, I always want to know, one, how am I doing towards my goal? So we spend some time at the end of the year or at the beginning of the year establishing goals. Now we want to know, how are we doing towards hitting those goals? The last thing I hate hearing when I go into a company or I'm working with the sales team is once a year we all say, well, great, Jim, we asked you to sell 3 million. It's now December 15th. We're at the end of the year and you sold 1.5. Because that just leaves me as a business owner in a really bad spot. And for Jim, it leaves him in a bad spot too, because, you know, we know Jim is working hard to make sales, but what have we done along the way to make Jim successful? So this is something that I think everyone, it doesn't have to be this complicated, this colorful, or this fancy, but I certainly think it's something that we should really start to look at, because it becomes that opportunity to have a checkpoint throughout the year.
You know, and something I'll work with this, I worked with a lot of the account manager side. So for some of you that have organizations where you may not work on maybe the larger projects, I found that having a sales goal, even for an account manager who's selling enhancement work and working with companies who are doing, you know, a $3,000 job, a $500 job, you know, and their goal could be $10,000 a month in enhancement work. This is important. And knowing that we have, you know, the ability to say, here's what we did this year, here's what we did last year. And so we can have a comparison, a year over year comparison. It really gives people the confidence to say, okay, if I did $10,000 last year, I could certainly do it again. So it gives, you know, with these smaller goals, Don't make this something that was, you know, indiscreet. Don't make it down. Don't downsize it or downplay it. It is really an important piece, even for some of the enhancement sales that you do. And so the account managers can really start tracking this, get confidence in their own ability to provide value to the client.
So let's talk a little bit about a sales professional, sales team members, or sales managers. typically what we're dealing with is we're probably dealing with somebody that's a competitive individual. I would say most sales teams that I work with, that's how I would define their sales teams. They tend to be your more competitive individuals. So metrics are key. I think metrics help us as a leadership team with making the right decisions. I also think it helps us as a individual with knowing where we stand, knowing how we stand with the other members on our team or other managers on the team, to make sure we're all headed the right direction. It's also going to tell us as an organization, you know, are we doing what it takes to be successful, and are we doing the right things now to make sure we're impacting change later? So what I like to do is, you'll see on the left, we're actually looking at the individual manager by month. And then on the right, you're looking at essentially the division as a whole. So the company as a whole. So where are we as a whole with all of the managers combined? And then on the left, where are we as an individual at tracking towards our goal? So you're going to see really quickly who your underperformers are, who your overperformers are. And our net is we want a team to be working together. So the ultimate goal is, you want to see if I've got five sales team members, if I've got two sales team members, or if it's just me alone, I want to know, is my team driving towards the goal, our graph on the right? And if they're not, where are my opportunities for improvement? So where are the people hitting the mark? Where are they not hitting the mark? And how do I not hit them with a stick to make sure that they're getting it done, but how do I help them be more effective in what they're doing to make sure person A on the left is going to hit their numbers for January? Because we know if everybody's exceeding their goals, then we as a company, we as a whole, are going to be more effective. So this gives us a great opportunity to look at different meetings. So how do we check in with these individuals? So a simple acronym that I like to use is PDCA. Plan, do, check, and adjust. So obviously our items and goal are what we are planning. That is our goal for each sales manager and for each department. Then we're going to do, that is our green, what you see in green, which is what we are actually selling. We're gonna check in. So we're gonna do our weekly one-on-ones. We're gonna do our sales team meetings. We're gonna do our sales quarterly meetings. And we're gonna check in to see how our trend lines are looking in relation to our goals based on our actual. And then we're going to adjust. If we're starting to look at 6 months in that it's looking pretty obvious we don't have it in the pipeline to reach the goals that we set at the beginning of the year, what can we be doing to either A, adjust to make sure that we're going to hit those goals, or A, adjust to make sure that we're adjusting operations and organizations to make sure that we aren't overstaffed or too full, too fat. That we need to run a little bit more lean, knowing that we may not hit the marks that we're trying to hit.
And Chris, I guess while looking at this, the check-in process, you know, in many organizations that we work with, we see that these things may start being utilized, but the communication back and forth and a consistent check-in isn't really there. And so, you know, two primary meetings that we've looked at and that we like to talk about. One, overall, you need to have a sales meeting with your team. If it's you and you alone, then you need to carve out time for you and you alone to look at these things and intentionally make progress towards the goals and how you're going to make a difference. If you're working with multiple people in a team, then overall, you need to have a team meeting. And the three, four, five, however many of them you are that are in the group, come together and you look at the overall progress towards the goal. And if we're underperforming or we see some ways to be more efficient to get to our goal, we talk about it out loud, and it's a way we brainstorm and we help each other out. The other meeting, so the team meeting is number one. Number two is, if you have people that report to you as a business owner, or you're a sales leader in your organization and people report to you as other salespeople, you need to have a one-on-one meeting. And that's what we call a consistent one-hour meeting every week, that you sit down and talk about this. And there's a focus on how you guys look at these, the tracking towards your goals, the pipeline, and the other metrics that you have involved, so you can make progress towards hitting those things. And that's where you can give guidance and you work through the idea of how you get better as a group.
Yeah, because as a team, as a sales team, my biggest takeaway for everyone in this is that you're a team. A team is not one individual. A team is multiple individuals. So for a sales team to be successful, we want to make sure we're lifting up even the weakest team member on that on that squad, we also want to make sure that our high executors are executing and continuing to execute, knowing that we may have some people that are not hitting their goals. So let's make sure we're looking at it from a team focus and not just in an individualized sales manager focus. Mm-hmm. Understanding your target market. The ultimate thing that we want to drive through here is relationships matter, and they matter at all levels. And I give ultimate credit to that phrase to one of our clients, Complete Land Sculpture in Dallas, Texas. That was something we took away from them, that they've done a phenomenal job with their sales team and being able to drive that and making sure that each person on the team understands that these relationships matter. They matter at all levels. So let's talk a little bit about what that means. Relationship building is about more than just talking to the owner of an organization. I found the most successful sales sometimes start at the bottom. And what is the bottom? The bottom could be the guy out in the field swinging the shovel. Mm-hmm. The bottom could be your homeowner who's the end user. The bottom could be the person that's at the front desk when you walk into the office. Jason, how many times have you walked into an office to do sales and you can't get to the owner because somebody's guarding the door and basically saying they're not here, even though you see the car parked outside?
All the time. It's the gatekeeper. On a commercial level, the property managers are never available. I don't know what it is, but they're busy 99% of the time. But that person who's at the front desk can always give you a wink and go, hey, Jason, yeah, they're here. They're a little busy. Give them 5 minutes. I'm going to let them know you're here. We'll make some time for you. So you got to get to know those gatekeepers.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
So when we look at the phrase, relationships matter at all levels, what can we be doing to make sure that we're executing at that level, right? So how do we start to make sure that we're networking with those people? We want to make sure that we're respecting their time. We want to make sure that we're scheduling with them. We also want to make sure we take time out of our day to make sure that we acknowledge them. You know, I would say the most important person to know is a person that may be the gatekeeper. It may not be the gatekeeper. It may be the person that's doing the AutoCAD input for a landscape architect. You know, it's not always the owner that's going to be the one that's going to be your decision maker. So it's important for us as a team to realize that as we focus on all levels of the relationship, ultimately, it's going to yield the customer a better experience in working with our organization.
Chris, what are some things you do on the front end to get to know somebody more on a personal level so you can start building these relationships? What are maybe a few things, tips-wise, as you're getting to know potentially a new landscape architect or a builder or a property manager? What are some things you might go after?
That's a really good question. So, I would say the biggest thing is I try not to make it about the sale. I try and make it about the person. I try and make it about the relationship. I'll be the first to tell you, Jason, I've got a terrible memory. I've learned a long time ago that I'm not one to remember something, and I'm really bad at remembering names, but I found I do have a knack for remembering people's schools. Mm-hmm. So I've always tried to focus on something that I know I can relate on, you know, and for me, it's as simple as, you know, asking the question, you know, hey, where'd you go to school? You know, where are you from? Mm-hmm. You know, because I've found that it's just something that sticks with me. I may not remember a name. I'll always remember a face, but I'll always remember where they went to school. So for the Aggies out there, I will always remember that, you know, and for anybody else out there, I will certainly remember that as well. But I always try and focus on knowing something about the person. And really, it may be 2-3 meetings before I actually even introduce the fact that I'm actually trying to sell you anything. I want to get to know you as a person. I want to get to know what your needs are, what you're looking for, and maybe how I might be able to serve those, or maybe I might just want to be a resource for you. Maybe I don't have anything to sell you at all. I just want to be a resource for you. But understanding that I'm here for more than just to get your business is really where I've tried to focus. So great question.
We have a quick story on this. I have a client we were working with, and they were having trouble selling maintenance contracts. And so this is new maintenance. That would be a yearly program in the commercial world. And they were having trouble selling new maintenance contracts on a bigger level. They were selling some smaller projects, smaller programs. But they had some opportunities with a property manager, and they kept getting pushed away. They were more just looking at the pricing of these things. And so they were battling price, which we'll talk about here in a moment. But the bigger thing was they were trying to build a relationship, but they just weren't getting through. Finally, after a few more follow-ups, the conversation happened to be, all right, well, this person has hurt their ankle, they've gone through surgery, and they're at so-and-so hospital, so they're not available to talk about the current, you know, bid that's gone through. Well, as a way to understand, we've talked to the gatekeeper, asked what, well, do you know what their favorite soda is and their favorite candy? Perhaps maybe some reading, you know, let's ask a few more details about this person. We put together a gift basket with all the things we felt like was more of a personal touch, found out where the hospital was, sent a note with a gift basket and said, hey, we're thinking about you, realize you're tied up in the hospital, get better soon. Love to visit with you about the bid when you get better, when back to the office. That ended up giving them the last look, which is always what you want. You want to get your bid in first and get the last look. Got the last look on the bid, was able to get the numbers where they needed to be and won their first big project. So don't underestimate building the relationships and going after it and intentionally knowing a little bit more about your clients. It will win you business. It also builds you some great friendships along the way.
I think the number one thing you said there, and if I can quickly recap that, is you listen for the answer. Mm-hmm. Right. And listening for the answer is, you know, sometimes people will call us to do a maintenance bid, or we may be wondering, why are they not buying trees from our nursery, but they're buying them from the other nursery? The simple question is, have we actually asked them, you know? And if we do ask them, 9 times out of 10, I'll tell you, your customer is probably going to tell you exactly why they either let that maintenance company go, or exactly why they refuse to buy trees from your nursery versus the other one, you know? And so let's just be open and honest. Let's ask the question and let's listen for the answer, you know, because the customer is going to tell you why they're looking for somebody. If we just ask the right question and we listen to see what their concerns are.
Well, there's we work with some new sales teams and Chris and I have worked with some that their number one challenge when they're not selling work, we find, is they overtalk it. We find that we have so much knowledge and industry information and technical expertise about what we do in our companies. And we're working with clients that don't know any of that. And we can overwhelm them and we can overtalk it and we can oversell it. And so a lot of times it gives us the opportunity just to step back. And if we listen more and ask the right questions, they'll tell us what they want to hear. So it's absolutely a great way to do that.
Value proposition. So know what differentiates you from your competition. I would say as a sales professional, this is the number one question you can ask yourself. As a business owner, I think this is the number one question you can ask yourself. And as a business owner, if you went and asked your employees, Jason, what would you like to hear?
I'd love to hear specifically what differentiates ourselves is that we're value driven. You know, we help people, we find a need and we do better work and we are above and beyond, you know, the right answer, whatever that may be. Price is definitely not it.
Yeah.
So it's not value driven by price. It's value driven by being helpful and making the right solution.
And I think it's to take that one step further. It's looking at what makes you unique, you know? So if I'm growing trees and I'm selling trees to a variety of different landscapers, landscape companies across the country, you know, are most of my clients, are they residential focused or are they commercial focused? Mm-hmm. Because my trees may look a little bit different, you know, or my, the high-end tree provider where, you know, hey, we don't do ball and burlap. We're just digging our trees specifically, and we dig them from this unique section of the state, which maybe has sandy loam root balls versus sandy root balls, you know, because that's going to matter for my clients in North Texas versus my clients out on the Gulf Coast. Those are all questions that we want to know. So where do we fit in the market? What makes us unique? You know, as a landscape company, questions I typically would ask myself, you know, am I providing landscape maintenance to just strip malls or multifamily multi-use, or am I working in Tanglewood in Houston where it's high touch, high volume, or sorry, not high volume, but high touch, intimate details, working with private residences and estates, you know? So knowing where we fit in the market is a really good question when you're looking at what differentiates you from the competition. And the reason why we want to know that is ultimately if I work in high-end estate management, but I'm bidding malls at Willowbrook or in North Texas, chances are my pricing structure is probably not gonna look the same. It's gonna look very different. You know, so let's look at our value proposition and what we bring. That being said, if I'm looking to get into the mall sector, maybe they are looking for a high-end provider, and maybe what I provide is what they're looking for. I just need to look at how I customize my approach to make sure it fits for what they're looking for. So make sure you know what differentiates you from your competition.
I can say single-handedly the biggest approach, and Chris and I, and we were working in landscaping full-time, our number one differentiator was speed. You know, when clients call, we were able to meet with them and turn around a proposal if it was under a certain dollar amount, didn't require a landscape architect design, obviously, within 24 hours. How many of us can say we can turn a proposal around in 24 hours? And being able to get back in touch with the client and say, when they're excited about hearing from you and they want to get to the point where you can review some things, that will help us understand, wow, that's exciting. It's as simple as one thing sometimes. You know, we want to do quality work. There's a lot of companies that do. But the speed of getting that estimate back to somebody means we were the first ones to get a look. And a lot of times we've got the work because other people never got back to them at all. So you may look at some simple differentiators that'll make a difference.
Aligning your sales teams for success. I've got a great quote in here. When targeting, less is often more. A shotgun may work for marketing, but a sniper rifle is an excellent sales tool. Great quote that we took from a book, Sales Simplified, that we were able to share with some of our peer groups that we work with. And it's a very simple concept and one that I think we can all relate to. And for those of us that are hunters, for those of us that aren't, just to kind of quickly share, a shotgun is what you might use for bird hunting. We got things going all over the place and we're trying to just clip one a little bit to take it down versus a sniper rifle. Sniper rifle is going to be a more specific target. It's going to be something that's going to be measured. It's going to be focused. It's going to be something that we're going to really try and hone in on exactly what we're going after. So how do we apply this to sales? So, I mean, generally, if we're sending out blank marketing to the entire west side of Houston, we don't exactly know who's receiving those mails. We don't exactly know who's reviewing those or how they've been reviewed or if they've just went straight into the trash. You know, if we're looking at it from a sniper approach, we're looking at here's a sector of the market that is going to fit exactly what my value proposition is. I'm going to go as deep into it as I can. I'm going to make sure that the money I spent here is equal to the return that I think I'm going to get. And I'm going to take that sniper approach of making sure that I'm targeting in exactly where I want to be. For those of us that don't know exactly what that is yet, yes, you might have to start with that shotgun approach first to kind of hone into what that is. But the ultimate goal is we want to get to that sniper approach where we know dollar spent in marketing is a dollar returned in sales. And we want to be able to see that, track that, and equate that to what we're doing. Hunters versus gatherers. I think as sales professionals, we've all heard this before. And what I love to say is zookeepers are not hunters. What would you describe as a zookeeper, Jason?
Account manager for maintenance is a zookeeper. Someone that likes to build relationships, but doesn't necessarily like to go build new relationships and gain new clients and is always looking for that next new thing. These are people that like to maintain the same relationships and gather the business that comes from that. And there are personalities and both are equally important in your companies.
Yeah. So zookeepers, ultimately, exactly what Jason just said, zookeepers are the people that it's not that they're bad. I think zookeepers are awesome. I think they're great. And I think every team needs an unbelievable team of zookeepers because ultimately they're the ones that are managing the relationship and keeping these clients happy. Mm-hmm. But we also know that new business isn't necessarily the target for a zookeeper. The target for, you know, those are going to be our hunters. Those are the people that aren't afraid to go out there and make the phone calls. They're not afraid to walk into the office or make the introductions or go to the events. So having a healthy balance, and what I want to encourage everybody today is that we want to build a diverse team. We need a team that is equally balanced both between zookeepers, our managers that are managing relationships and fostering opportunities. But we also want to have some of our hunters, the ones that are out there not afraid to shake the trees, go find new opportunities, and go out there and seek those opportunities and have the persistence and the consistency to follow up with those over time to make sure that they're effective. Mm-hmm. So,
and as just to get a little bit fun on the talk today, I am a self-proclaimed zookeeper, and next to me is Chris, our hunter, for sure. So getting us in the, we've been very successful in our sales approaches. And at the same time, you can perform at a high level having both of those kinds of people on your team.
Yeah. So what I would encourage everyone, and for the business owners out there, or the sales managers, embrace the fact that they're not you. Mm-hmm. You know, the way you approach sales, or the way you approach sales management, it may be the right way, it may be the wrong way. What I'm going to tell you is, it's both. It's not necessarily right, and it's not necessarily wrong. But what you can do is embrace the fact that they're not you, and they may have a different approach. They may do it a little bit differently, and that's okay, because diversity is ultimately what we're going for from a sales perspective. And having a team that's diverse, but knowing where each other's strengths and weaknesses are, is ultimately what's going to make you the most effective sales team. Coach up or coach out? This can result from several different aspects. So one, maybe results are lacking. Two, team is noticing the lack of results, or maybe we're continuing to have poor meetings. So the question is, how much time is too much for hanging on to a bad performer? And this is a great question. And I think Jason and I have probably varying experiences with doing this over time. And I can tell you, I'll be the first to tell you, I've probably hung on too long in a lot of instances. And in some other instances, I probably was too quick to move. And I may have made a decision before actually kind of vetting it out. Mm-hmm. But common rules that I would like to apply is, ultimately, if you feel like you've got somebody that's not performing, I think the first question you need to ask before you coach out is, you need to see, make sure you've exhausted all options to coach this person up. So if you have a person who's underperforming, what are you doing to make sure they're effective? What are you doing to make sure that they're in the best position to be successful? And if it seems like they're not making sales, maybe the question we need to ask is, have I even been on a sales call with this person? Have I even seen what they're about? Because it's not easy to replace a sales professional. I mean, it's. I can tell you, with the recruiting practice we have, I mean, finding talented sales individuals in any market in the U.S. Is a challenge. And I think with every year that goes on, with the generations that we have, it's becoming more of a challenge over time. So coaching up has become ever more critical than it ever has before. So I would tell you, I'm probably slow to coach out. I'm probably slow to walk away. I'm going to spend most of my time coaching up and helping to facilitate growth and training before I'm willing to just cut these people and move on.
The other piece to that, if you're on the call that's not necessarily, you know, you have a team to work with, and that you are the leader of this team, maybe you're showing us as an individual sales performer. I've always learned a ton by going with someone else doing sales. And so me spending time with Chris is a huge value. If I'm just going to be a supportive person and a smiling face, shake hands and add some humor to it, and I watch how he sells and what he says, I'm learning from that. And so don't consider yourself out if you don't have a leader that's showing you this. Find another sales professional that you can go shadow and learn how to do some of these things for yourself.
Sales recruiting. So we talked a little bit about this at the beginning. So what I can tell you, and the experience I've had hiring sales managers, working with sales teams, is the good ones are happy, and they don't usually come easy. And they're probably not out of a job and looking for a job, you know. So relationships are everything. Culture is everything. Go ahead and work on building your bench. Jason, how many times would you interview people 12 months out of the year, even if you weren't actually hiring for that role?
I'll take every interview. I mean, there was not a week that I did not interview. If I had someone that was interviewing for a sales role, account manager, even a production manager role, you name it, it was important for me to know who was out there so that when we were growing and we were ready to add somebody, we could. Yep, it's very important.
Yep, because it's all about building your bench. I can tell you, your best hires and your best professionals are always going to come when it's the least convenient. Mm-hmm. You know, and what I typically find is, 9 times out of 10, when you're looking, they're not out there. And when you're not looking is when you might have an opportunity to land them.
Absolutely.
Aligning your sales teams for success. So what you'll see on the right here, I'm going to talk through this briefly. And this is kind of a generic team structure for in this instance, we'll assume a landscape design build maintenance company. And so what you're going to see is you're going to see a variety of different roles. So we talked a little bit about diversity of team and what is diversity of team. So diversity of team is figuring out where people's strengths are, figuring out where the weaknesses are, and then putting them in a position to be successful. If we can do that, we can do that effectively, what we're going to find is, one, we're going to keep salespeople from eating each other, and we're going to put them in a position to be successful and motivate one another. You know, so when you have a healthy team environment and you have a team of people working together for a common goal, and not feeling like they're stepping on each other's toes, not feeling like they're undercutting each other, not feeling like they're working against each other, what you're going to find is you're going to be more successful as an organization. And when you can get that success to translate, it's unbelievable the places you can go, you know, and it's very exciting when you start to feel that momentum, because when it starts to happen, it's a slow turn, but when it starts to turn and the wheel starts to turn and all the wheels start turning together, it's amazing how fast it can start to go when you really get the momentum behind you.
Absolutely.
So we're going to talk a little bit about value forecasting and backlog. I'm not going to go in too much depth on this, but I do want to stress a little bit of the importance. Is forecasting and backlog is exactly what it is. And I get varying degrees and various input on how people feel about that. Me personally, I feel like it's absolutely critical to running an organization. So you can't get to where you're going if you don't know the plan to get there, you know? So if I've got a pipeline of opportunity, what I want to know is, you know, when am I going to do this work? You know, and one, do I have the crews to do it? Two, if we were to land all of this, what happens now? I mean, because we only know a working day is so long, and we only know that we only have so much bandwidth to be able to get through it. So we need to know what that is. We need to know how it's going to land. We need to make sure we're building a team that's built to win. So, I mean, to build that team, what we got to know is, I don't want to load up 10 salespeople if I have 3 production crews, because what I'm going to find out really quick is they're going to outsell what my production capabilities are. And that's a big problem, you know, because that's going to take us right back to our value proposition of, can we deliver our value proposition if we can't actually execute the work that we're selling? So we need to make sure that there's a healthy balance between sales and production. That should be a healthy discussion that we're having on a weekly or a daily basis. And we need to make sure we're focused on driving through that and making sure that the team is aware of where we're at on that, and that we all are working together to make sure that team is going to win at the end of the year.
You know, and that small example next to you, that is the little org chart, if you guys are looking at the slides, Chris has done a nice job of looking at how to segment this out. So forecasting a backlog. I mean, if you have somebody that is selling new design and installs, and it's residential, most likely those are going to land for you in the near term. But what about the homes that are being built that are still just barely breaking ground? Start making relationships happen so that 6 months from now, when you're ready to present a design, those are already in your pipeline. Also, on a commercial level, you're looking for groundbreaking things where there's a new development coming in, or there's potentially a new piece of real estate that's being developed that 12 months from now, you would have the potential to have a bid and go into that pipeline. So that's how you start building the backlog. And Chris has a nice example for you here, how he segmented that out. And as you get larger, you might specialize in which potential salesperson goes after what.
So I want to make sure we leave some time at the end for questions. So we've got a couple more slides for you, and then we'll go to the questions. So core competencies, aligning your sales team for success. What you're going to look at is, you know, basically, Texas or team diversification. So we want to make sure that we're putting the right people in the right markets to be successful. So what does that look like? You know, so I'm going to give you a couple examples. So in the state of Texas, there's a distributor that we work with that sells lawn equipment in the state of Texas. And so they have the entire state broken up into 3 territories. And those territories are broken up between 3 specific individuals. So I'll tell you a little bit about the individual. So individual one focuses on dealers that work with landscapers. Individual two is a technology-driven focus. He's more of a millennial mindset where he's looking at the computer side and how does technology relate to my customers. And individual three handles a lot of the rural markets, and he's more of a hands-on dealer focus. So what is unique is, you know, hey, would individual three work inside a metropolitan area? In this case, no. Individual three is a hands-on guide that's working with farmers and ranchers out in the fields. He's working with nursery producers and growers. And he's the guy you call when you have something that broke down and I just need to know, hey man, how do I fix this? You know, he's the right guy for that job. Going back to individual one that's working in our Metro Focus. He's moving quick. He's moving fast. He's also working with, you know, 60 landscapers versus two landscapers in a rural environment. So he's structured a little bit different. He organizes his time a little bit different. His method of follow-ups are very different. And individual two is technology focused. Individual two, I'd say, covers the largest territory, but he's actually able to do that because he's able to use technology effectively with a client base that understands how to relate with him on that level and be effective on that level. And between the three of them, they've now taken Texas, which is a new market, and made it one of the top five markets in the country as a supplier. And so the company that we're actually talking about is Arians in Gravely. It sells maintenance lawn equipment. And they've been able to drive Texas into a big producer, big opportunity here locally. And so I thank JW for sharing some of those facts with me with his team and doing that. So to quickly wrap up as we start to move into questions. So a couple takeaways we'd like to see you all walk away with today. And next time we see you, love if you ask us some questions about this. But what is a sales process? And what we want to drive you to is have one, use it, and be consistent. Number two, understanding your target market. Know what it is. Value proposition is you need to understand it and you need to live it. And you need to live it in all aspects of your business. Relationships matter at all levels. And finally, aligning your sales team for success. Set your team up for success and you can plan for it. Mm-hmm. And with that, I'd like to open it up for questions. If y'all want to send those in, and then Jason and I will see those pop up here and we'll try and address those as quickly and as effectively as we can.
And again, this is James. Great job, guys. People can type questions down using the chat feature or the questions feature, and it should pop up to our speakers, and they will be able to see those and interact with you in real time. So feel free to type in now. We'll give it just a few moments here.
While the questions are coming in, I just want to point out a couple things. We'll have a slide here that has our contact information if you'd like to reach out to us to learn more. I'd also like to tell you a little bit about some of the stuff that we have coming up. Obviously, we're going to be on the Monday webinar series. We've also will be at Grow this next week in Denver, Colorado. We are currently starting some peer groups, if anybody is interested in peer groups. And then we'll be at the TNLA Nursery Expo in August. So look forward to being with everyone there. And then we'll have a slide here in a minute with next month's webinar as well.
Go ahead and put the next month's webinar up there, guys, if y'all would.
Sure. Yes.
I guess you answered all the questions. People aren't typing questions here.
This is a quick review of what Chris just said. If you guys want to take a snapshot of this on your screen, you could certainly have that. And then I'll move on to next month's webinars.
So just a common question we like to get is, you know, what size do I need to be before I'm having a sales team meeting? Jason, what would you say to that?
If you are a single owner operator and you are still out there trying to make things happen, the only way you grow your business is if you sit down and have a meeting and you're intentional about growing the business. So at all levels, I would say even if you're a startup under 500,000 and you're a single owner operator, you should have a sales meeting. It is the single most important thing you're going to do to grow your business and do it profitably.
Yep. And we all know that unless we're focused on it, it's not going to happen.
We have a few questions coming in here, guys. See, I knew people had questions out there. So the first one comes from a grower. He says, how do you approach inefficient communicators, quote unquote, customers, question mark?
That's a great question. I'll start with this and maybe Chris can help me finish it. So inefficient communicators, it's really setting the expectations of how we can help them. So in a lot of ways, education is part of the process for us. So when we go into it, let's just say they're hard to reach people. And when you try to reach them, they're just never, it's just one of those things that's continuously hard to just get in touch. So if we start on the front end and go, listen, our best way to help you is for us to stay in a good communication process. And so what's the best way to do that? Are you better with via phone? Are you better with email or texting? Let's figure out the right format that we can communicate on a regular basis, that I know when I'm reaching out to you, I can get an answer in the same day. So for instance, we lay out the 5 to 10 rule. 5 to 10 rule for us is if we're getting an answer or we got a question from somebody today that happens before 5 o'clock, we're gonna respond to it same day. Today, before I go to sleep, I'm responding. If it happens after business hours, I'm responding by 10 a.m. the next morning because I wanna show a sense of urgency to my own clients. So I expect the same thing for my clients to me. And I just lay that out on the front end. I know that sounds bold, but it actually works.
Yep.
All right, we have another question. This is from an outdoor lighting company. What data should be included in the CRM?
That's a great question. So, well, it's going to look different for everybody, but you being a lighting company, we'll kind of focus on that. I mean, so really what I want to know is, you know, one, I want to know everything that's a pipeline opportunity for you. So if, and pipeline opportunity for me isn't just if it's an actual lead, but if it's somebody that shows interest, that tells me that they've already kind of come to the conclusion in their mind that they're interested in lighting. And that's an opportunity for me that I should be driving towards. So one is the pipeline opportunity. Two is maybe a forecasted close. You know, in my discussions with them, when might they be interested in actually performing this work? I want to know what that is so that I can be strategic about how I follow up with that person. And I also want to know some simple stuff like dollar values. You know, I want to know, hey, I've met with this customer maybe, and I know that this could be a $1,500 low voltage lighting proposal. I want to know what that is. Another common one that I really try and track with all companies is, how did you hear about us? You know, was it from a website? Was it from our trucks? Was it from a referral? If it was from a referral, you know, who is that referral? But I always want to know where that information's coming from and how we're reaching these clients. Because ultimately that's going to tell me down the road, am I spending my marketing dollars correct? You know, or am I going down the right path to get to these clients? If it turns out they're actually finding me from another form of communication.
Yeah.
All right.
Especially I have another fundraising things, right? If you're spending marketing dollars on certain events and certain campaigns that you're doing within your community, and it turns into a lot of leads, you would definitely want to know that.
Another question here. How did you develop your sales process?
That's a great question. We messed it all up. I would say it comes from trial and error, to be perfectly honest with you. It's not being afraid to try something, step off the edge, make a mistake, and go back to the drawing board and do it again. Mm-hmm. So I would say neither one of us are trained in any form or fashion in sales. I have a horticulture background.
Mm-hmm. Mine's hort and business.
But Jason has a hort and business background. So it's come from trial and error. It's come from experience. It's come from doing it the wrong way and understanding how not to make the same mistake twice.
Mm-hmm. All right. We have a couple more questions here. And I've been having a few people ask about CEUs. Feel free to email me, certification@tnlaonline.org. Just email me and I will send you the links to find the CEU form. So those who are asking that, email certification@tnlaonline.org. Here's a question here. When keeping in touch with your clients, have you noticed a serious shift in people preferring email or social media instead of a mailed content or direct calls? Next question. Do you have a preferred system for track of these preferences for your clients?
I have historically tried to meet them with what's comfortable. I have some clients that I would say majority of my follow-ups are text. I have some that may be through social media and some that are through traditional formats of I actually go sit down with them at the office and say hello and see them face to face. So it's not so much about what am I comfortable with as a sales professional, it's what is my client comfortable with.
Absolutely. I mean, there are definitely ways to track that too, to answer the second part of that. I mean, the CRM is one way. If you have prefer to go into a software program that can track communication, that's certainly one way to do it. We did it old-fashionedly. We just write up in Microsoft Excel. You know, we've got our pipeline, and on one box of follow-up comments of what we did, here's my follow-up dates, and here's a few notes of what we talked about to help me track where we're at. But anytime we'd have a phone call, I will say we did back it up in writing. Like if we had a major phone call that had a lot of information to it, one of our successful ways to make sure we captured it all and the client was going to tell us, you know, they didn't forget anything, was that we recapped it and say, here are the five things we talked about. I just want to make sure we're all good to go. We're going to get it scheduled on this date. And here's when, you know, here's our next steps. And every single time our client would go, oh, I forgot to tell you this. Don't forget to do this. This is important. You need the gate code. And I have a dog, you know, it was interesting. So the recap email was always an important piece to what we did.
Okay. I have two more questions here. Then we'll have to wrap this one up. Regarding the hunters and zookeeper, how crucial is it to have those separated?
I don't know if separation's the key. I think it's understanding where your strengths are and understanding where your weaknesses are is the key. Let's not force a zookeeper to be in a hunter box, and let's not force a hunter to be in a zookeeper box, because what you're going to find is they don't fit. It's fitting a square peg in a round hole. But I think it's very important when you're meeting as a team that we address what that is. You know, obviously my assumption would be is most times your commission structures are going to look very different between the two. And they probably should look very different because, you know, your risk factors are different and your relationships are different. So I think it's more getting them to work together side by side and understanding what that relationship is, so that they're working together versus working in their own silos.
Chris, I completely 1,000% agree with. We work better together than we do in some cases a lot separately, because we have different personality approaches to these things. So it's actually a great benefit to learn how to work together.
Okay. And for those of you who we didn't get to on their questions, feel free to email the certification at tnlaonline.org with your question, and I can forward that to McFarland Stanford. But last question here. In a competitive and price-sensitive market, how do you suggest not selling on price, quote-unquote commodity sales, and focusing on value?
Make it about the product, and make it about you as a resource and providing him the answer and the solution.
The biggest scenario I'm gonna go with this on, Chris, is the experience. People will pay for a better experience. So somewhere down the path, whether you're a nursery vendor and you're selling plants, or you are a landscape provider or a maintenance provider, you can add something to make the client experience just that much better that your competition is not doing.
Yep.
Okay. And finish up there.
Yep.
That should be it there. I appreciate everybody staying on. We went 2 minutes over time, but that means everybody was attentive, and this was some great information. Again, please join us for next month in March, where we'll be having the next webinar with McFarland Stanford, attracting the right talent to develop the team structure for growth. Any final words, McFarland Stanford?
No, it's been a pleasure being with everyone today. We certainly look forward to seeing everybody at the expo in August.
Yep.
and connecting with you all individually so that we can put the face with the name. So don't be afraid to reach out to us and connect with us.
Everybody have a great week. Go sell something.
I like it. All right. Thank you very much. Have a great week, guys.
Bye-bye. Bye.